Welcome back to another episode of Beyond the Game with Hal, where we explore the journey of athletes and uncover the stories that shape their lives both on and off the field. I'm your host, Hal, a 14-year-old aspiring sports broadcaster. And today, I'm thrilled to have Gunnar Maldonado, linebacker and safety from Arizona. Gunnar is a standout player known for his remarkable skills and dedication to the game. In this episode, we've decided to dive into Gunnar's athletic journey, his experiences, and the lessons he has learned through the way of college football. Join us as we get to know the person behind the helmet, Gunnar Maldonado, and discover and dive into his excellence. Get ready for an inspiring conversation that goes well beyond the game with Gunnar Maldonado. Let's get right in.
You came out of Arizona high school. You won 4 state championships. And was a captain your senior year. What was that time playing like at the biggest moments in high school? How has that translated over to your college career?
I think the biggest thing is, like, when I got to Chandler High School, we had already been, like, a top program. And we had won state championships. So I think it kind of taught me to, like, when you come in as a freshman, just kind of really learn from the older guys. So when your time does come, you kind of keep that winning, like, mentality, championship mentality going. And so I think just being on a team like that, that's so competitive and so good, you expect to win. Like, when you walk into a game and expect to win, like, that's just the mindset you have to have. So I think that's what it taught me a lot, was just walking into games expecting to win, you know, no matter the opponent.
Yeah, and another thing with that is you got to, no matter, like, how hard the opponent is, you always got to think and know that you're going to come out with the best outcome so you can play. Half the game is mental. More than half the game is mental. You got to prepare and be mentally focused in there. Now you made great big plays in high school to lead that team. Like, and then you came in, you were a captain your last year. You came in freshman at Northwestern. And then you took kind of a backseat role. You didn't really play. You're learning from the seniors, learning from the people there. What did that year before transferring to Arizona mean to you?
That year was great. That year at Northwestern was huge for me because, kind of like high school, I came in, and that freshman year at Northwestern, we went to the Big Ten Championship. And it was the COVID year, so things were a little different, but that Northwestern team was a really good team, and I sat behind a lot of really good DBs. And just good leaders, like, man, like the Greg leaders Newsom. On that team. Yeah, Greg Newsom, I talk about it all the time. I swear, he was locking dudes up that whole year. I didn't see nothing caught on him all year. But Travis Willock, like, dudes who just know how to, like, lead a team. I think that was huge, just me seeing that, just seeing how they worked. And, again, that mindset. So that was huge for me, just learning that year, growing as a player, even though I wasn't really playing much.
Yeah. What was your process more to get to Northwestern? Because you had offers from Arizona originally, right?
Yeah, I had ASU and Arizona. Yeah. It actually came down to ASU, which is my rival school now, but it came down to ASU and Northwestern. And really the big, I just felt like, the people over there at Northwestern, and to this day, I say it, man, like, I loved everybody over there. It ended up just me kind of wanting to be a little closer to home. But I have nothing but good things to say about them. Like, Coach Fitz was amazing. Just everybody over there, man, the players, the coaches, the staff. But ultimately, I wanted to go to an academic institution that was, you know, held to a high standard. And obviously Northwestern is one of those, so.
Yeah, and then you came back to Zona. You were a captain last year. You're gonna be a captain again this year.
So last year we had a team vote, and so yeah, that's kind of how we did it. We have a new coach this year, Coach Brennan. I'm not sure how he does the whole captain thing, but I'm definitely trying to put myself in a position to be a captain again. So
yeah. And another thing with being a captain, leadership is obviously a huge role in football, dealing with ups and downs and playing an exhausting game, and you got to be locked in for the whole time. What does it mean to you to be a leader?
Man, it's a lot. I feel like a lot of people who are captains or leaders will kind of tell you it's not always the most fun position to be in, but it's something I take a lot of pride in, because I say it all the time. When you're a captain or a leader, you have to make sure you're on your P's and Q's before anything else. Because if you're not doing everything yourself, you know, just showing up on time, putting in extra, like doing the little things right, nobody's going to follow you. And so I think that's one thing about being a leader is you really got to be on top of it yourself. And then there's different leaders. There's different ways to lead. You know, not everybody's vocal. Some people lead by example or, you know, kind of hit smaller groups or people individually. But yeah, I think just being a leader, it's just a lot of, you just got to wear a lot of pride on you, man. You represent the whole team. You know, there's a few guys on the team that kind of like represent the team, if you will say. So yeah, just being prideful and making sure you're doing all the little things right, being a good person.
Right. And you said there's different ways to lead. Obviously, you could either be a vocal leader, encouraging people, doing that, but it's the same if you're doing the right amount of reps, doing them good, doing what you're supposed to be doing instead of like not doing the workout, let's say. You're talking to your a teammate, or in practice when you're in line for a rep, you're not looking at who's going and make corrections off of that. You're looking at, let's say, the quarterbacks. That's not what you want to do. You want to see every opportunity, and then other people who look up to you will see that and follow you.
Yeah, you right on. Like the coaches tell us all the time, when the best players are the guys who don't miss meetings, don't have missing academic appointments, don't have, you know, failing grades. When the best players are the guys who do that, usually the, you know, the rest of the team follows along. So, but I feel like in college, the biggest thing for guys is staying off a list. They always say stay off a list. And like, that just means being on time for lifts, meetings, academic appointments, grades, like having good grades, like no missing assignments, treating people with respect. Like those three things alone can just, if you just do those things, man, you're going to be pretty good. So,
right. It's doing the things that my coach always says to me, especially, it's the things that take no talent, being on time, listening, paying attention. It's the things that take no talent that you don't, that it's just, you should do that, which makes you a better player.
No, yeah, you said that perfectly. It takes no talent. It's strictly just character. And yeah, you said that perfect.
And then obviously you've gone through, I think it was three defensive coordinators you have in your college career.
It's about to be four, really, this next year.
So yep. You'll be going into your fourth.
Yep.
So what has that been like leading through the changes in that and you dealing with that and different schemes?
Right. It's a good question. I think it's definitely tough because I think one of the advantages of which I experienced last year, because it was my second year with Coach Nansen, was just going into another season, spending a whole off season knowing a defense, growing more in that defense. That can like allow you to take huge steps and just like how fast you're playing and knowledge of the game. But at the same time, I think having so many defensive coordinators might help me down the road. You know, when you know, if you're blessed enough to get an opportunity at the NFL, you know, once you get there, I think it happens fast. I hear a lot of guys talk about, you know, they show up for rookie mini camp or whatever, and that playbook, you know, they don't give you very much time to really study it too much. So I think that's also helped me, you know, being able to like see something in the install meeting and being able to go pack it up 20 minutes later on the field, because that's definitely a skill you have to learn. Like you have to be able to see it, walk right out onto the field and go make some calls. So I think that's also helped me.
Yeah. And then you said with changing it and getting to the NFL, that also helps, because if you are saying like you go to a team rookie minicamp, they have a different scheme than, let's say, you ran this past year, you could be like, oh, I did this 3 years ago. That's what it is. Comes right back to your mind. You got it there. And you also said with recognizing it, bringing it right onto the field, what is the mental part of the game and how do you prepare for that side of the game?
Man, the mental side of the game is everything. I mean, it's everything. Especially once you get to college, high school, you can get away with being an athlete. You know, at some places, once you get to college, man, everybody's fast. Everybody's strong. Everybody's tall, big. I'm by no means the biggest guy. And so mental game is huge for me. But in terms of like preparation, man, having a good coach is having a great coach is like can just set you so far ahead. Like Coach Aquina and Coach RC at Arizona right now, they're amazing defensive backs coaches. And because they watch a lot of film, like they're watching more film than really anybody because they're at the facility all day. Like we have school and stuff. But I think the difference between like your freshman season and like your like junior season is like freshman year, you're learning the defense. Your junior season, that's when you're really learning offenses more. And I think that's kind of when your game will like level up is like you're not even really thinking about your own defense. You know how the defense works. Now you're really thinking, okay, what formation does the offense do this in? Or what do they run when they get into this? When they're in this personnel, on this half of the field, on this hash, you know what I'm saying? When they motion, when he's in the game, all this stuff, when the tight end's off, when the running back's in front of the quarterback or behind the quarterback. There's just so many tells, and that just comes with literally just watching film. And I mean, I'm sure you're on top of it, but when you're in a college football, when you're in a DB meeting in college, man, we rewind the same play about 100 times before it moves to the next one. And it's just like, you're just looking for tells, man. And once you start seeing those, you start to feel the game. And once you start having that feel for the game, my coach Aquina, he always says, if you can run 4.4, but you can't, but you're thinking like 4.6, 4.7, it's not going to work. He's like, I'll take a guy who runs 4.6 that plays at 4.3 any day of the week, because those guys are just, they're ahead of it, man.
And it's just like, it's basically, I like to go by the saying, like, you know the game, but you don't know how to play the game. Like, you're kind of getting more into it, but then as you go on, you learn more. And that helps you do other times.
Yeah, no, yeah, for sure. But I would say, yeah, just knowing what the offense is doing, having that feel is everything, man. Because if you're anticipating rather than reacting, it's night and day. Because 9 times out of 10, man, the offense is built. They're in a position to win that battle. But if you are anticipating, then you have a good shot.
And another thing with even those practices, those reps in practice, I read something about you having harsh battles and very intense battles with now NFL receiver Jacob Crowling. How did that help you and have those battles with those great players into games?
Yeah, me and Cowan, we would always go at it at practice. I think part of it is just because we're two very competitive guys. Like football, I think it just shows that football means so much to us, you know, because, you know, once it was over, once the practice was over in the locker room, we're cool. Dap it up. Good job, man. How can I get better here? But going against him, man, it one taught me, which was big for me, just like next play mentality, because, you know, he practices too. He's a great athlete too. He's going to make plays. But one play doesn't define you as a football player. So if you come, you know, you got to come back and make the next play. Definitely taught me that. But, man, going against Colin was just great because it was just back and forth. It teaches you how to – he's a very explosive player in it, and you have to play against him kind of a certain way, and it taught me that. So,
another thing is you said, like, you can't let it affect you in the locker room. You can't – you got to have that, like, next play mentality. I always like to live by the quote that someone else in an interview actually brought up to me, and it stuck with me, is you can't let one loss beat you twice. So if you lose one rep, you lose a game, you can't let that carry over to the next rep, next game, which is probably a big thing that happened, is if you lose one, you got to get back at him next time.
Yep. No, yeah, that's huge, because mental is everything. And if you can't have a short memory and forget about that last play, it's going to affect your future plays. So, yeah, that's huge. I like that.
And it's the same thing with, like, that 24-hour rule after games. Like, if you lose, you got 24 hours to think about it, reassess. But if you win, you got 24 hours to celebrate, and then it's on to the next game.
Yep. And it's so, man, you really realize that when you get to college, because college, you know, winning in college isn't easy. And you win, and you know, it's fun, but you come back the next day, watch the film, and it's over with. Now you watch the film on the next team, so it's right. Cool.
And then another thing that helped you perform at the biggest level, I mean, obviously your bowl game, you ended on the highest note possible with the pick six, unbelievable plays in your bowl game. Obviously, you gave a lot of credit to your defense after that game around you. What does that mean to you to have strong bonds with the players around you?
Man, it's everything. It's everything, man. Those are the guys that you spend all day with, and those are the guys that make it happen. I mean, you know, you and me both know, but like maybe somebody who's just a casual, you know, viewer of football, on a defense, 10 dudes can do their job right. But if one dude doesn't do his job, it's 6 points. And so anytime a big play happens, man, it was never just one person. You know, if a DB gets a pick, it's usually because there was a pass rush and the quarterback had to get the ball out, or it was a good, you know, reroute by a DB, or just all those small little things, man. It's to me, it's never just one person. So especially in a big play like that, especially, you know, man, I love that play. Teams blocking for me and trying to get in the end zone. It's just always about the whole defense, never one person.
Right. And when one of the best, like I watched the highlight, I screenshotted almost at the end. You could see like three of your teammates blocking for you. And that must have been like a special moment, having few people out in front and you're chasing them. It's like a full circle moment, full team getting in there.
It was real full circle for me because the two dudes who were out in front of me are like my two best friends on the team. Mm-hmm. And so that's something we'll always remember.
Yeah. And now you guys brought back most of the team for this next year. And you guys did that together. What was your kind of motto for that, to like run it back?
Yeah. It was a weird time when Coach Fish went over to Washington because
what's his name? Went to Bama, right?
Yeah. Yeah. The Washington coach went to Bama. Our coach went to Washington. Yes, sir. And because basically you have 100 guys and no head coach. So it's weird. And with the transfer
program, right. It's like when coach says, go do this drill. And there's like one position group maybe doing like a warm up drill, but it's 100 players, a whole team being like, what the hell do we do now?
Yeah. And it was just a super weird like couple of days. And especially with the transfer portal and the good season we had, you know, a lot of guys are going to have options to go other places. And a big piece was our quarterback and receiver, Noah
Fifita. Fifita and T-Mac.
Noah and T-Mac were huge. Jacob Manu was huge. And just the idea of like, man, we don't have to do what everybody else does. Like, we don't have to transfer to find better opportunity. Like, we don't need, you know, you need a great head coach. Don't get me wrong. There's great head coaches that lead great teams, and it's an important position. But at the end of the day, man, the people on the field are the most important ones. And we just felt like, why not keep it here, man? Why not just build what we have going already? And, you know, I think for me personally, that was huge. But then also, I wanted to finish somewhere I would, you know, have an impact on. I've been at Arizona for 3 years now. I spilled blood with the program, as my coach would say. And I love that place, man. I love Tucson. I love the University of Arizona. I pride myself on being from Arizona. So like, I wanted to finish somewhere I'd be remembered at. And I think that's a great spot for me.
And especially with like the NIL and the transfer and making all this money. I mean, everybody wants to go get more money, go to a higher program. But at the end of the day, if you want to win, you got to keep the team together. And that's the problem these days, is everybody's moving on. Like a team that was maybe from a smaller conference, they all leave, go to power conferences. But a team like you guys, I mean, you guys are still in a power conference. The Pac-12 will be the Pac-12 to Big 12. Yep. You guys kept it together with a chance to go do bigger things as a team.
Yeah, and I think you know, some dudes get hate for leaving for more money. And, you know, I don't think that's necessarily right, because, you know, different people are in different situations. You know, you never know what that could do for somebody.
You never know what one kid's grown up as compared to another.
Yeah, no, for sure. You know, I think you know, everybody's making the best decision for themselves. But at the same time, I do think you have to see, like, especially if you have aspirations to play in the NFL, the school that's offering you the most NIL might not always be the best situation for you to get to that next level. I'm not saying you can't, you know, I believe that, you know, if you're a player, they'll find you anywhere. But also there's some great people around the country at certain places that may be able to, like, develop you better. And I believe in that as well. So.
Yeah, I believe it's all about finding that right fit for you.
Right.
Another thing about you is I saw you're a big tattoo guy. What are the tattoos and what do they mean to you?
Yeah. So I got my first tattoo in high school. On my shoulder, a Jesus piece. Been growing in my faith a lot. I got some more like religious tattoos, but it's just a big part of my life. And there was just nothing else that I really felt I needed at the time, especially to start off with tattoos. But the rest of my arm, I kind of got creative. I'm a big music guy. I play guitar. So I got a couple of my favorite guitar players. I got Slash from Guns N' Roses. I got Jimi Hendrix. This is actually going to be funny because he has a fight coming up, but I got Conor McGregor on my arm.
You a big fighter guy?
I like the UFC. I do. Yeah. But honestly, more than that, though, I'm a big Conor McGregor fan, which is funny because I never – and, you know, at first glance, you know, people who know me might think that I wouldn't like him, but kind of learn more about his story and everything, and I love that dude. He's, like, my favorite athlete. And then I have, like, a whole chest piece, too, but I think tattoos, you know, you definitely want them to be meaningful. But at the same time, I think, me personally, I think it's art at the end of the day. And so I think finding that balance of meaningful but still making it look good and art and that kind of thing is cool. And I have a great artist.
Up here in Phoenix. Tommy Lee.
Tommy Lee, man.
I heard the story. You were with him at like midnight and you had a 6 a.m. run. Can you kind of tell us a little more of that story? Because I was really interested in that.
You did your research, man. That's awesome.
Pride myself as much as I can in these.
No, that's dope, man. So basically my cousin had gotten tatted by him like a couple years ago, and I loved how his tattoos looked. Like, it just, when you see it in person, it just looks different. It's a different kind of ink. And I had been trying to get in with him. And so we scheduled something like 6 months out. You know, he gets real booked. And I was down in Tucson working out. And he texted me like, yo, I had a cancellation. If you want to come get tatted. So I did my 6 a.m. workouts with the team. Drove up to Phoenix. Probably sat in the chair from 11 to midnight. Got my whole outside of my arm tatted and drove straight back to Tucson. Probably got there at like 2:30, 3 in the morning and had a 6 a.m. team run the next day again with a fresh tattoo that I just spent all kinds of money on. And, you know, I put a sleeve on it, but it was just like a brand new tattoo. You're not even supposed to really like work out when you first get a tattoo. You're not supposed to sweat. But I was just so determined to get in with Tommy, and that's how it went. And it worked out, and I'm happy. And now me and Tommy are real cool, so it's a lot easier to get in with him. But that was a fun story for sure.
I mean, it's always nice to have those bonds with people who aren't necessarily like your family or your close friends with football. That is someone you just met and you became close with them.
Yeah. No, and that's exactly what happened with me and Tommy, man. Because me and him are real cool now, and I think he appreciates how I appreciated his work. You know what I'm saying? And I showed that appreciation. I think it turned out good.
All right. To end it off here, final 14 questions. Been doing this with everybody. Let's get them.
All right. Let's get it.
Who's your idol?
My Tata Raw, my grandpa, man.
Favorite fast food place?
In-N-Out.
Biggest fear?
Biggest fear? Ooh. I'm going to say snakes.
Favorite school subject?
Math.
Favorite influencer or YouTuber?
Inky Johnson.
Favorite gym workout?
I'm going to say curls.
Favorite musician?
Blast.
Favorite animal?
A dog.
Favorite TV show?
Ooh. Demon Slayer.
Biggest pet peeve in a person?
Ooh, pet peeve? I'm going to say when they cut me off.
Is a hot dog a sandwich?
No. No way.
What's your favorite emoji to throw in your text?
I probably send 100,000 laughing emojis a day, so I'm going to say that.
And then, are you a shower singer?
Oh, for sure. 100%. You're going to hear me.
Thank you once again.
Yeah, man, you're doing great, for real.
Thank you. Good luck on your season.
Yes, sir, man. Appreciate you for having me. Appreciate you. Have a good one.
See you, Gunnar.
All right. That I've always needed. Like a drum, baby, don't stop beating. Like a drum, baby, don't stop beating. Like a drum, baby, don't stop beating.